teams that know what they're doing and two teams that have great athletes on both sides, then usually the game is decided by the team that hits the hardest.
Thank you. where I was brought up. The hitting game and my position calls for not being hit. When they hit you as hard as they can and you pop back up, then you go, oh my God, I tried to kill this guy and I didn't hurt him. I just might as well, you know, it's going to be like this all day. I just might as well just tackle him and get him down.
Thank you. Revolver Stadium, champion products out of the coaches today at a noon luncheon. For the first time in years, Clyde Savannah was not at the luncheon. East Rochester beat the eight-time defending champs over the weekend, and now they will face Caledonia Mumford. It's Coach Ron Rucker's first time in the finals, and beating Clyde Savannah to get there meant a lot.
We defended them real well. Had a lot of pride in our defense, and they were a high-scoring team this year in Section 5, and we didn't allow them to score on us. Now coming against Cal Mon, you know, they're another big scoring team. They're bigger than Clyde, which will present some more problems for us. They really outmatch us in weight. Hopefully our quickness can overcome that.
Next Sunday night,
your reign as Section 5 champs came to an end. The Bombers and East Rochester Road senior tailback Mark Laurier for 129 yards and two TDs in their 17-0 win in the Class C semis. Now East Rochester goes into the title game against Cal Mum. Motivation won't be a problem.
Coaches probably don't have to get the kids up as much for these games as they do during the year because naturally the kids are going to be more emotionally high going and playing in the Bombers Stadium.
Hello, everyone. East Rochester has not won a Section 5 football crown since 1985, but the Bombers can come of age this weekend as they take aim at their first championship of the post-Don Quinn era. Here's Micah Dean.
What I want in here is to understand what we have to do against the eyeball.
Defense. That's the main reason East Rochester is back in the Class C championship game. The Bombers' defense ended Clyde Savannah's eight-year reign as Section 5 champions.
Well, right now we're just going to savor the moment and live it this weekend, but Friday night, there's another game, bigger team. We're going to rise the occasion and we'll play a lot of heart, and hopefully we can come out Section 5 champs.
There's not a lot of teams playing high school football this time of year, and the Bombers feel fortunate to be one of the few. If you would have asked them back in August, none of them would have expected to be here. Not only was the UR line questionable, Rucker had to fill three assistant coaching positions at the last minute.
We had all ER grads working with us, and so it was kind of easy for those guys to just carry on the tradition and the work ethic and know the plays, in fact. So it's kind of all new to the other people, but I think they knew our tradition, and they were happy to come to work here and see what it was like.
The tradition is success. The Bombers want to bring it back Friday night. I'm Micah Dean for the 10 o'clock report.
Thank you. Championship on TV 10 with Rich Punky and Rick Hagler.
High school football begins in the hot, steamy days of August. 64 teams from Hilton to Hornell, from Batavia to Bolivar, practice twice a day. Then, in September, they began to test the plays they hoped would carry them to the postseason. High school football ends 3 months later in the unpredictable days of November, where the opposition includes the elements. 24 schools made the playoffs, 12 made the championships, and 6 went all the way. Sports presents the Super Six, highlights from the Section 5 football championships.
There was an added incentive at Fauber Stadium this week, with 4 of the Super Six advancing to a state playoff at Rich Stadium next weekend. Good evening, everybody. Thanks for staying up with us, and welcome to our recap of this weekend's championship games. I'm Rich Funky with Rick Hager, and weather-wise, it got colder as the weekend went on, but for the most part, it stayed dry, and if you're a coach or a player, that's really what you care about.
Yeah, not a bad weekend at all. Just a little bit of rain on Friday, on and off, and that's where our coverage begins tonight on Friday night. The two teams with great football tradition met in the first game of the championship weekend, Cal Mum and East Rochester. ER had knocked off 8-time winner Clyde Savannah in the semifinals the week before. Caledonia Mumford was unbeaten heading to the finals, but they started the championship game in a big hole, their own 4-yard line. The Red Raiders went right to work with their punishing ground game. R.J. Hildebrandt plowed ahead for 9 yards and some breathing room. Cal Mum continued to roll over the Bombers. Dave Donahue spun away for a 30-yard gain to the ER1. Quarterback Gary Hartford finished the 96-yard drive, a drive that was executed completely on the ground. It was 6-0, and Cal Mum had established the early edge at the line of scrimmage.
Get in here. If you don't believe this game is won in the trenches, I'll tell you what. Keep your feet moving and don't let them penetrate. Now let's block well. Let's get some points on the board and make this a ball game.
But still, ER had trouble stopping the run on Cal Mum's next possession. Donahue, behind more good blocking, ran for 43 yards and a 12-0 lead. An ER field goal made it 12-3 at halftime. The Bombers had hope, but clearly needed to stop the Red Raiders' running attack.
The line's got to do it. It's only 12-3. We get the ball a little bit more.
Cal Mum got the ball to start the second half, but the Bombers, behind Kevin Bulling, stopped Hildebrandt on third down. ER had an opening, and they went right to Mark Loria, one of Section 5's best backs, and Loria turned in one of the weekend's best runs. The 59-yard scamper cut the Cal Mum lead to 12-9. But Mike Monticelli's Red Raiders continued to grind it out. Donahue rumbled for 30 more of his 189 yards on a fourth-quarter drive that put the game away. Donahue, the game's MVP, scored his third touchdown to make the final 27-9. Red Raiders churned out 406 yards rushing. For the grounded Bombers, it was the end of an exciting 7-3 season, while Monticelli's unbeaten Red Raiders showered in the success of a championship for the first time since 1987. And Cal Mum is now 10-0, and they are certainly big with 2 200-pound running backs.
And Mike Monticelli took over for Bill McAlee, who won 4 sectional titles at Cal Mum, so this was extra special for him, that's for sure, especially after losing in the finals last year. In the second half of the doubleheader, we had a defending champion and a team that jumped up 2 classes. Livonia, with just 1 player back from last year's title team, took on the Cuba Rushford Greyhounds.
Livonia upset top-ranked Midlakes to reach the finals, but against the unbeaten Cuba Rushford Greyhounds, the Bulldogs were distinct underdogs again.
We know about the barricades that wait along the track, but we have set our soul ahead upon a certain goal ahead, and nothing left from hell to sky shall ever turn us back. Yeah!
drove for a field goal on its opening possession, then forced Cuba to punt. Junior Mark Kress lost the ball, and the Greyhounds had their first break. Scott Beaver recovered at the Livonia 15. Three plays later, senior Eric Poor went 4 yards for the touchdown and a 7-3 lead after one quarter. The Cuba defense, coming off a shutout in the semifinals against Perry, came up big in the second quarter, stopping Livonia's Pat Finn on 4th and 3. Cuba took over at the 40. Livonia coach Steve Giromo knew the next series would be crucial. But using the ground game, Cuba drove to the 7th. And with 8 seconds left, Ben Hulbert went to the air. And Greg Rogers made a brilliant catch to make it 14-3 Cuba at halftime.
We're going to go out. We're going out with our wheels spinning, with our guns firing. There ain't anybody out here. And there isn't anybody out here better have a drop left in that bucket. You understand me?
Yes, sir!
We're going to empty that doggone thing on the field, give them everything we got. We're going to be the bulldogs that we know is in each and every single one of us. You hear me?
Yes, sir!
Livonia knew that to stop the Greyhounds meant getting a leash on Max Freeman. But the junior halfback was unstoppable. Cuba took the opening kickoff and drove for a TD. And Freeman, the game's MVP with 208 yards, went in from 31 yards out to give Cuba a 21-3 lead. There was a flicker of hope when Livonia came right back on its next possession. Craig Hill took the pitch and picked up 36 yards down to the Cuba 10. Three plays later, Pat Finn went in from the 1. It was 21-9. But Livonia never found the end zone again. Cuba added another touchdown to make the final 28-9. For Cuba coach Calvin Mosher, a perfect 10-0. And the tougher division made Cuba's first title that much sweeter.
This was Cuba and Rushford's first season as a combined district in Allegheny County, and while it forced the program to jump 2 classes, only 1 player was added from the Rushford system. So they took a big jump, and they didn't get a lot more kids to go in with the program.
But they did get the trophy that they were looking for. Next up, a look at Saturday's doubleheader, and later our annual musical salute for the high school football season. Game that matched 2 rivals. Hornell and Dansville are only 17 miles apart. They play once every season, but this year they met a second time in the Class B Championship. Hornell won the regular season game 21-7.
The Red Raiders came to Faber Stadium unbeaten. The Mustangs were riding a 5-game winning streak, and they struck first. Dansville quarterback Neil Weidman found Greg Spencer wide open for an 11-yard score, and it was 7-0 Dansville in the first quarter.
We gave up. Now, wait a minute. We gave up a touchdown because of penalties. Let's put bodies on the ball, and let's knock it down their throats here.
Hornell coach Gene Maston thought his team had Dansville stopped the second. The Mustangs lined up for a field goal. Weidman mishandled the snap, but recovered and threw to Aaron Morrow for a fantastic 15-yard touchdown. Dansville coach Mike McMullen planned to fake the field goal. It didn't go as designed, but the result couldn't have been better. And the Mustangs led 14-0 at the half.
Listen, gentlemen, the whole game, the whole second half, all right? This is catch-up football for us. We're not up. This is catch-up football for us. We're not as big as they are. We're not as strong as they are. Avoid their strength. Any questions?
No.
Okay, baby, let's go out. Let's go.
Hornell tried to heat it up in the second half. But each time the Red Raiders mounted a drive, the Dansville defense, led by Lenny LeClaire, shut them down. Hornell quarterback Greg Helmer was sacked 5 times. Helmer finally got the Red Raiders on the board late in the game with a 17-yard pass to Mike Hillman. But that was it, and the final score was 14-6, giving Hornell its first taste of defeat in 1991.
Don't show him that. Don't show him that. Chin is up.
The Red Raiders still took a 9-1 record back home to Steuben County, while Dansville enjoyed the double thrill of beating a bitter rival and taking home a Section 5 trophy.
And Mustangs coach Mike McMullen took over in 1987, the year after Dansville won its last Section 5 title.
The second half of the doubleheader had a team going after its first sectional title after being frustrated in the tournament several times before. Batavia was hoping to repeat a 26-7 victory over Rondequit, which had occurred just 3 weeks ago.
while the underdog Indians were hoping for a repeat performance of last week's upset of Aquinas. Aranda quite knew it would have to play another perfect game and control the football, and control it they did. On the opening possession, quarterback Brian White and running back Jeff Stewart each converted third downs on the ground. Then they hooked up through the air on fourth and six as the Indians moved to the Batavia 19. Three plays later, White faked to Stewart and took it in himself to cap a 17-play, 80-yard drive that lasted 11 minutes.
Believe! 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 Believe in yourself!
Batavia ran just one play in the first quarter and ran just two offensive series in the half. Rodney Bridges stopped the first one by sacking quarterback Rob Hale. But on Batavia's second possession, a break. Facing fourth and eight at the Irondequoit 35, Hale went to the air. Rich Hartman was not the intended receiver, but was in the right spot at the right time and took it in for a touchdown to make it 7-6 at halftime.
You can play with them. You can beat them.
Second half team, let's do it all. Come on.
Irondequoit scored on its first possession of the second half. A spinning, twisting Jeff Stewart went in from the 19. The Indians had a 14-6 lead.
You gotta stay hungry.
Batavia's next series was critical. Hale converted on fourth down, and then Hale, facing third and 11, went to Jake Torcello, who took it down to the Irondequoit 1. From there, workhorse running back Jeremy Hunt took it over, and the Blue Devils trailed 14-12. Batavia decided to go for two and the tie, and Rob Hale found his favorite receiver, Chris Regal, and it was 14-all after three quarters. After forcing Irondequoit to punt on its next possession, the Blue Devils took over at their own 31. Again, Hale hit a key third down pass, and with Jeremy Hunt running the ball and Hale scrambling, Batavia moved to the goal line. From there, the senior quarterback dove in for the go-ahead touchdown. Irondequoit still had 4 minutes to work with. Their final drive began at the 20, but stalled quickly. Facing fourth down, the coaching staff decided to go for it. They made the right call. Todd Pasnak was open. The drive and the dream was still alive with a first down. The Indians moved into Batavia territory and faced fourth down again. But this time, Brian White was run out of bounds, just short of the first down, and it was over. Batavia ran out the clock for a 21-14 victory, and the school's first Section 5 title. Those sectional championship games and the titles, the first ones especially, are really emotional. And you know, Batavia really is a great football town. Seven head coaches from Section 5 live in Batavia, including Wade Bianco. And four of them now have won sectional titles.
And I bet John Kreitz probably the happiest tonight.
For sure.
Of all those coaches in Batavia. And when we come back, we'll look at today's doubleheader. Today's doubleheader included a thriller between two small schools and the power of the largest schools. We'll be back in just a moment.
Shot by our photographers, Steve Richards and Todd Hayes.
And let's move now to this afternoon's doubleheader. And first off, the two smallest schools in the finals provided the weekend's wildest game. In Class D, Bolivar from Southern Allegheny County met Dundee of Southern Yates County for the championship at Favre Stadium.
Come on, let's go!
Ed Allen's Dundee Scotsman scored first. Bolivar answered, but Dundee came right back with their second touchdown. Sophomore John Sutterby connected with Joe Croft. The two-point conversion made it 16-6 Scotsman. Just before halftime, it was Bolivar's turn. 6 foot, 5 inch Pat Matheny threw long. Jamie Johnson was covered, but made a great play to grab the touchdown. Bolivar had cut the lead to 16-14 at halftime. In the third, the Bolivar Bulldogs took the lead. Matheny to the air again, this time to Rob Green. Bolivar again failed a two-point try, but still led 20-16. It stayed that way into the fourth. Then Dundee's Anthony Smith, a junior, broke it around end for a 39-yard run. Dundee was back on top 24-20, but needed more to hold on. Mark Bassett, the game MVP with 157 yards rushing, scored from 8 yards out as Dundee used 4 two-point conversions to beat Bolivar in Class D, 32-28 was the final score.
And those two-point conversions were very important. Both teams scored four touchdowns, but Dundee had the conversions and won the game.
And with today's win, Dundee had a chance to play at Rich Stadium next weekend. And the winner of today's Class A game also had the opportunity to play one more next week. There was no secret about this one. East High was taking its speedy ground game against the powerful ground attack of Fairport, the number one team in the state.
This is for you, for Fairport, for everything that we stand for, everything we love so much. Everything that we love so much. The Red Raiders, baby. Red Raider pride. Let's do it upright. Here we go. Let's go.
Fairport won the toss and marched to the East High at 34. Facing fourth and two, senior John Keogh kept the drive alive, picking up five and a first down.
Lyman, read the D!
Seven plays later, it was Keogh again over the left side for the touchdown. 16 plays, 15 of them on the ground, and a 7-0 Fairport lead. East High was forced to punt on its first possession, and Fairport found the end zone again after starting the drive in East territory. Matt Logan, who rushed for 101 yards, picked up 12 down to the East 17. Then Jason Kaiser, following the left side blocking anchored by Pete Sozio and John Fingler, took it in. And with a two-point conversion, it was 15-0.
Way to go. You all right?
Yeah, thanks.
Way to go out there. Way to go. Way to go. Way to go.
East got on the board in the second quarter after an exchange of turnovers. Quarterback Omar Baker, on the option, kept the football and moved to the Fairport 35. With Fairport intent on stopping East High star Michael Lewis from running the ball, Charles Banks was wide open in the secondary, and Lewis hit him for a 35-yard touchdown. And with Baker tanking in a two-point conversion, the Orientals were right back in it. It was 14-8 at halftime.
We don't have a chance to work our offense. We aren't getting the football. They had the ball 9 minutes in the first quarter. We had it for 2.5. They wanted that half more than you did.
In a whole half.
East mounted a drive to start the second half. Michael Lewis, at 6'2", 220 pounds, is the area's most heavily recruited running back. And he took off on a beautiful 32-yard run to midfield.
Come on, D! Let's go!
The drive stalled at the Fairport 27. And facing 4th and 15, Omar Baker was sacked by Joe Condis. Fairport had the ball at the 40 and proceeded to tack on another touchdown. The Red Raiders controlled the line of scrimmage, and John Keogh did the rest, going 15 yards for a 21-8 lead. While the Fairport defense frustrated the Orientals, turnovers and penalties out of frustration also combined to hurt East High. Roan Calder lost the ball on East High's next possession, and the Red Raiders recovered, setting up another touchdown by Jamie Lyle. And the defense put a final and forceful stamp on the victory. Michael Lewis could not do it alone. East was held to 163 yards on offense. Lewis had 101. Fairport rolled up 348 yards and won its second title in 3 years, 36-8.
Love you, Coach.
Love you too, baby. Happy birthday. Yo, what a great day, huh?
What a great day for a birthday.
Yeah.
Those birthday congratulations were going to Joe Manhertz, who turned 18 today. Happy birthday, Joe. Fairport certainly looked like a number one team in the state today, but until there's a statewide competition, you really don't know for sure.
Maybe we're getting close to one. It seems like Section 5 is spearheading the drive for a state tournament. This year, four Section 5 teams will meet Buffalo area teams at Rich Stadium, and we'll have those matchups next.
Stadium next Saturday.
And it all begins at 1:30 when Dundee faces Ellicottville of Section 6. Then in Class C, Caledonia Mumford battles Silver Creek at 3:45. That will be followed by Batavia against Grand Island at 6. And the windup next weekend at Rich Stadium is Fairport against Jamestown at 8:15.
And what a great thrill it's going to be for these Section 5 players to play at Rich Stadium, the home of the Buffalo Bills.
It certainly will be. And finally tonight, we want to congratulate our Section 5 athletes, officials, coaches, cheerleaders, wives, moms and dads for another great season.
Football's a great game. It's a game that teaches so many things: teamwork, discipline, overcoming adversity, and attaining goals. Memories of Friday nights and Saturdays on a football field last a lifetime. And with that in mind, photographer Todd Hayes produced this memorable look at the 1991 season. For all of us at News Team 10 Sports, good night.
There's more to football than just going out there and hitting people and running plays, scoring touchdowns and all that stuff. To me, football is it's the bonding of a relationship between my friends and I, and it's memories that'll last a lifetime.
Such a team. I mean, we all love each other, and it's like.